in Rio Island they have a single stage anaerobic digester. The current volume is 5,300 meter cube, I guess. And the temperature is 38 degrees. So we are trying to make a similar one as our control digester. We have a digester, and we use a 2-liter LMR flask as a digester. And our volume is currently 1.5 liter. And we use the same temperature as here, 38 degrees. And their SRT is 31 days, sort of, and we are using 30 days as our SRT. So this is the control digester.
Can you also teach us how to set up your vessel for that 30-day SRT? For example, how do you come up with flow rate, for example?
So the SRT definition is V over Q. So this is our flow, and this is the volume of the digester. So as here we have 1500 milliliters, and we want the SRT to be 30. So here we come up with 50 milliliters. So I'm trying to make a continuous flow, semi-continuous. So every day I'm feeding my digester 50 milliliters and taking effluent 50 milliliters.
First you take out, right?
Yeah, first I take the effluent, then I feed. And then I have two T-pad configurations, which is a two-stage anaerobic digestion. The first stage is the thermophilic, and the second is the mesophilic. So we are separating the methanogenesis and acidogenesis phases. So the first stage, as the first stage is thermophilic, I'm using 155 degrees, and for the other T-pad, 70 degrees. And the second stage is again 38 for both. And I'm considering the SRT for the first stage 2 days, and for the second stage 28 days now. Because I want the total SRT to be same as the Lulu Island and same as the control. After I get enough data and my reactors are stabilized, I'm gonna reduce the SRT of the second stage to find out the breakthrough point of my configuration. So again, this digester is 1.5 liter and this is 1 liter. I'm feeding the second stage with the effluent of the first stage, and I feed it with the first stage from the raw sludge, same as control. Anything else?
So what is your raw sludge exactly? Because they have the spreadsheets from Lulu Island,
yeah,
which indicate different sludge streams, right?
Yeah, I use the mixed sludge. So in Lulu Island they have primary and secondary, they mix it, and the influence of the digester is the mixed sludge. So I'm currently receiving mixed sludge from Lulu Island, and I'm using it to feed my digesters.
And what are the typical, you have maybe that information part of your
which information?
TS and VS concentrations of your feed and etc.
I don't have it in this PowerPoint.
Okay.
Let me see.
Maybe then write it down there if you know the levels for your mixed sludge.
I'm not sure if I can remember the true value. Was it around 15%?
Based on the how thick the mixed sludge?
Yep.
So I think it's 3.5%. No?
The TS and VS?
Yeah. Your mixed sludge.
I have a summary of Lulu Island data. Let me check it in my computer.
Okay. I can bring that Excel file.
I have it here.
when those two streams are thickened, the concentrations will be 4%.
4.23 total solids.
Yeah, so that's the mixed sludge. Okay, so 4.23% total solids and 88% of it is volatile. So you can write it down, maybe beta, for your feed going into the first stage.
Okay.
So mixed sludge has TS of 4.23%. And volatile solid is 88% of this percent of TS.
So it's TS.
Yes, so the ratio is 88%.
I also found the summary file.
Okay.
I have the removals here. So currently they have around 60% TS removal and 70% VS removal. The effective volume is 5,300.
Okay.
And these are the characteristics of their two digesters that they're running in parallel. HRT is 30 days. Temperature is 38, same as us.
And one receives flow of 0.18 megaliter per day. So if you, for example, have a means, so they have these two, right? And then their Q1 is 0.18 megaliter per day. Q2 is almost the same. So based on these effective volumes, these are all liquid volumes, so we do not consider the gas space, head space. We calculate, you guys can double check these calculations, but it sort of corresponds to 31 days of detention time. And they have mixed sludge coming in around 4.32%, and then based on what's coming out, they have VS destruction around, so 4.32% times 88%. If this is, for example, I'm just giving a number, 3% VS. They have 65% of removal, so VS coming out is basically 3% of this, so probably 1.2% VS. That's your baseline scenario. So when you, in order to calculate your VS removal, you go by VS coming in, VS coming out, divided by VS coming in. So that's your removal efficiency. So these tables were from the same spreadsheet, right, Beta? That, so you guys should be able to have the access to this data as well. So that's your baseline scenario, pretty much.
This is the characteristic of the primary sludge.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the secondary sludge. And here's the mixed sludge.
Okay, there we go. So 4.
Okay.
So that's volatile solids of 88% is not correct.
It's
the
ratio.
Ratio.
Yep.
Okay, so ratio of 88% of that 4.23% is volatile.
Mm-hmm.
So it corresponds to 3.7, something like that, percent VS, which means 3 point something gram of volatile solids present in every 100 gram of sludge sample, right? So
Okay, Bita, keep going.
This part is done.
Okay. And so Bita is running although we have data from full-scale digesters, which was summarizing those two tables before. We want, because there may be seasonal changes in the performance, we want to run both control and T-pads at the same time. That's why Bita set up also control here. So maybe Bita, show us the performance of control, your control digester first.
Okay, I have them all in one table.
Okay, that's fine. Maybe you had the biogas production. Let's start with the biogas production of the control. You had a graph.
Black one is the control with green spots.
Okay.
So this is the control. It was my first digester that started from the first day. As you see, it's kind of stable now.
So she is feeding 50 milliliters of mixed sludge to simulate the baseline. Every day it is, because we are feeding the same flow rate, we expect to get same biogas production. It's a stable system. And average Bita, what is the biogas volume that you get out of the system? It looks like around maybe 1,000 and... Okay, so if you... So this is easier to read. Liter of biogas per liter of digester. Because we have 1.5 liter, if we divide all the volume of biogas we get by 1.5 liter, we are getting just below 1 liter of biogas for every liter of liquid volume. And if you compare this with Lulu Island current system, Bita, do you have data on that?
Data for what?
The Lulu Islands
biogas.
Yeah. Just to see if we are actually reading the same volumes. Do they report gas volume for digesters there? Because we know they have 5,300 cubic meter.
No, I don't think, not here. Maybe,
not there.
Maybe in the other one. Oh, it's nitrogen is full.
Sometimes it's difficult to measure it accurately at the full scale. They may not report.
Gas. Digester gas collected per day.
Yeah.
1.53% solids.
And then there is no volume of biogas. Just your flow thickener. So this is something that you can look into in the spreadsheet. Maybe it's there. I know they don't, since they flare the gas, they are not sending it to a cogeneration system. They may not care right now the exact volume. But if they have that value, Bita, in the spreadsheet, it is good to just check if... per digester volume, we are actually achieving the same. So if we are, that's great. That means we are simulating it exactly.
So in this table, I have the average value for the biogas that is produced by the control.
Okay.
per gram of gas that is fed to it every day.
Okay, so there are two ways that we can report the biogas from systems. We can either take the volume of the gas divided by the gram of volatile solids that we are feeding to the system, which beta is showing as the second row. And this is the motivation behind it is we can check this value with literature. Other researchers also report it this way. So I guess it is milliliter in this case, right? Is it liter or milliliter?
It's milliliter.
Milliliter of gas over gram of VS. So, and then we can check with literature if that corresponds to a typical sludge digester volume.
So in here, the unit 695.92 would be the milliliters of gas collected?
Collected per day divided by gram of volatile solids mm-hmm. fed to that digester.
And the other one is in the format of input output?
Which other one?
77.82, 104, that would be.
Oh, 77.82 is the standard deviation.
Yeah, that's the
okay,
deviation.
So statistics. Okay.
And then the number beside it is the number of data points that she
okay.
is using. Because it seems like she has been feeding this system 404 days.
Okay.
She's gathering one data every day.
Okay.
So that's the average and the standard deviation of data collected from 104 days. Because that was the first digester you set
yeah.
up, right? The other vessels, they have been running a bit
yeah, the
less.
The TFAT 2 is the final ones.
Okay, so the other columns belong to the TPAT
yeah.
processes.
Do you want to take a look at the graph again first?
Yeah, let's look at the graph first.
Something is wrong with my laptop today.
It doesn't project the way you...
It's not shown on there what I'm seeing here.
Chagat, it's connected.
Oh, what's the connection? What are you getting?
Yes.
No.
Try making everything smaller.
Shows the difference in pH of the two.
Well, it's the temperature, right? Higher temperature, lower pH.
Yeah, which makes sense. Because the acetogens will actually produce, well, acetic acid. And the methanogens will consume it to create your good old biogas. So far from what I expected.
So the reason why they have 2 days and 30 days is just to...
It's because the whole process is faster than the other. So it doesn't need to stay as long.
Mm-hmm.
So basically the thermal process can process the sludge in a smaller volume at a faster rate than the halogens are going to take a long time either way, so you just throw in a larger volume for a longer time. If you want to get any sort of meaningful results, that is.
Mm.
question from TPAT. So TPAT, meso, they are the second stages, mesophilic ones.
Yeah.
Right, 38. And then thermals are the ones that are running at very fast organic loading rates, which means very short retention times. Because we are not operating the first stage digesters as a metanogenesis digesters, they do not do well in terms of the gas production. Because gas gets generated mostly. I mean, there is some volume in it, in the head space, but the methane percentages are very low.
Yeah, it's very low. I have the gas composition next to
it. Okay, Peter, keep going.
This is the liter of biogas per liter of digester. And this is the milliliter of biogas per gram of waste that we feed every day. So here, in the third row, we have the average values of the daily biogas based on the VS that is fed every day. As you see, we have kind of close values for the second stages of the two TPAT, but for the first stages, as I was using to feed the first stage of my TPAT one with the, I changed the SRT at the beginning, I had around 15 days. I changed it gradually, so that's why I have a bigger value for here. But currently, if I consider only the recent data, we will have a similar value to this one.
You mean the biogas production from first stages?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, it's more close to this one, but I consider all my data is from the beginning.
Okay. So, in any case, they are not generating much. First stages
are very low in terms of biogas
production, because their purpose is not really biogas production.
Yeah, I think so. Biogas
So the purpose is to start breaking apart large particles into small particles more efficiently at those temperatures. So we are not necessarily going after gas from the first stages. We are more interested in the solid removals overall as a system, which in comparison between the baseline and the TPAT scenarios, which are the data just below that row. Bitak, you can take the pointer there, so it will be better for you. So there's a pointer there. Maybe point to the removal data for us.
Living organisms, the niche limit is, do you remember how low it is?
It varies by organism. Some will be higher and lower cases than others.
C numbers like the 5.5.
That's because they're producing a lot of acetic acid.
Not towards us.
That's good for the system.
Because it may.
But it means that the methanogens are not happy.
So in terms of TS removal and VS removal, we have a bigger value for TPAT second stages. Comparing with the control, and same as before, we should expect a close value for the first stage of TPAT 1 and 2, but as I considered all my data from the beginning, it's a little higher, but if I consider the current data, it will be close to this one. So we don't have much removal in the first stage, but it helps the second stage to have more removal.
So if you, the question that we need to answer, if we add up the removals across the TPATs, like we have, for example, VS removals, which is more important, organic removals. So we have 35% removal here, and then we have 68% removal, whether it's okay to just add them up arithmetically and compare it with the baseline. Because if we do that, if you assume this is like 1.5 and this is 75. Right, so these are very high removals when combined compared to 66. And whether that is the best approach to compare.
Well, if you look on the left one for TPAD 1, 35 plus 68, you get over 100%.
Yeah, because you considered the original data, right?
So when we set up these digesters, what Bita was trying to say, because SRT2 is extremely short, we don't want to shock bacteria at very high order organic loading rate. So, Bita, what was the SRT that you started these first stage?
15 days.
So she started with a 15 days SRT, and then
I reduced it gradually.
The volume is the same, 15 days SRT. You start with a much lower Q, and then gradually shorten this down to 2. Not to shock the bacteria, that means gradually increase the Q. Right now she's reporting the entire data set from the beginning of that 15, but Bita, I think we should only report the data from the 2 days.
I did it last time, but you asked me to have all the data, so I did like this.
Yeah, but all the data for that particular
SRT
configuration. So otherwise, yeah, we may get into that over 100% removal issues. So steady state data from your desired SRT configuration. And then this will come down, you are seeing like 3%, right?
Yeah.
Something like that. But even if it is 3% or 4%, so it is 65%, still higher than the baseline scenario, which is good. It seems like it's promising. And ammonia values, you have, this is interesting. So something is happening at this temperature that your ammonia is decreasing. What is happening to ammonia at 70 degrees C?
I'm not sure, because I have only one data point for the TPAD 2 in terms of ammonia. I think maybe the experimental situation.
So when you increase your temperature, I think you are stripping off more ammonia to the atmosphere. That's why in the liquid phase, your ammonia values are coming down. And so you plan to gather more data, right, from here in the future?
Yeah.
And
because I, as soon as I made my TPAD 2, I left for about 1 month and then I came back, so
mm-hmm.
I don't have much data points for that.
Mm-hmm. And pH values are lower for the first stages.
Yeah.
And higher, because the first stage systems are operational under acidogenesis, so the acid concentrations are higher, which drives the pH lower. So I wanted Bita to attend these meetings regularly because she will be updating these. So I asked, there is one of our fourth year students, David, he is working for our group as a senior undergrad researcher. So he will be helping Bita to measure some of these parameters, and I ask them to measure at least every parameter once a week. So we will be getting updated statistics every week, and then now you have a basic idea in terms of what source of data you have access to. So by knowing that, you can start working on the spreadsheets. Some of these parameters you will need to size those TPAD vessels for the full scale. Okay?
This is the biogas composition.
If you look at Metcalf and Eddy calculations, for example, for estimation of the energy recovery from systems, you need to assume percent methane in the biogas volume, and we already have those data here because we have very low gas and methane in the first stages, so you will get recover most of the methane from the second stage in the system. So if you are, if Vita is getting 1 liter of biogas only, for example, 676 milliliters of it is methane. And the remaining compounds are there. And when you calculate the energy, that will be the 676 milliliters is the volume that you will be using.
In the real life scale, can we still do the summation of the both stages for the, let's say, methane composition?
So you, instead of summing the two stages, you have to do the calculation like the first stage, let's say, generated 20 milliliters.
So
you multiply this 5%, 4.97% by the 20 milliliters of biogas, which will give you methane in milliliter. And then you do the same thing for the secondary stage. Because they are not across the T-pad, they are not achieving 69 plus 5, 78. They are not achieving like that, right? Do you have to sort of use these to go to milliliter methane from each vessel and then add them up?
And as you see, for the first stages, we have so much nitrogen.
Yeah.
And also the CO2 is more.
Yeah. Because we purge these vessels with nitrogen when we first set up in order to remove oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
Because these are anaerobic systems, so presence of oxygen inhibits. So we purge them with nitrogen. And eventually, as the biogas gets generated, that nitrogen is purged out of the system. Every day, biogas is generated, so it has to go somewhere. It leaves the system, and then the nitrogen percentage is pushed out of the system. However, first stages, they do not generate much. So it takes very long time for them to purge the nitrogen out of the system, so they will read higher nitrogen in the head spaces for a long time.
Can I have another table for protein and humic acid?
Okay, yeah, let's look at it.
I'm not sure if the values make sense. Could you take a image? Because it was my first test.
So what are we looking at now?
The first two rows are for soluble and total protein. Oh, sorry, it should have another row though. The first column is, this is control, this is mesophilic for the T-pad 1, mesophilic for T-pad 2. I mean, should
okay, so
add the column.
The same as the other column. So control, T-pad 1, first stage 2.
So this is the feed, sorry, this is the feed, this
yeah.
is control.
Okay.
I think this is T-pad 1 mesophilic, T-pad 2 mesophilic, and then thermophilic ones. Yeah. So this is, for example, this is the first stage of T-pad 1, this is the second stage.
Okay, so maybe, Vita, best way for us to look at this data if you graph them. Okay, so so the idea of measuring soluble proteins and humic acid, so we are trying to understand what temperature does to our organics coming into the first stage. Because we have one system running at 55, another system running at 70. So if temperature is accelerating the hydrolysis, which basically converts larger particles into smaller particles, then if I am measuring soluble, that means it is shifting proteins, larger proteins, into soluble phase. From particulate to soluble phase, right?
That's what hydrolysis is. First large organics should be converted to small organics so that methane-forming bacteria can process them and change it to methane. So that's what first stage does. And if you change the temperature from 50 to 70 degrees C, you should be increasing soluble protein to total protein ratio.
And HA is a humic acid?
That's the humic acid. So if ratio was 50 at this temperature, for example, 50%, which means 50% of the total proteins were in the soluble phase. Remember the definition of soluble phase. If you filter your sample, the particles passing through the filter paper are the small particles that are smaller than 0.45 micron. And particles stuck on the top, they are particulate proteins. So if temperature is actually enhancing this process, what you would be seeing is the temperature increasing, you're soluble to more and more proteins are shifting from particulate to soluble phase. So you should be seeing a graph like that. And if we do this for proteins, if we do this for humic acids, if we do this for carbohydrates, lipids, then we understand we have a deeper understanding of why temperature of the first stage is making a difference. So this is more of a research level. That's why I asked Vita to measure proteins and humic acids, and she will measure also carbohydrates soon. So for us to understand whether it's actually this shifting phenomenon that's helping us. So if you go back to the VS removals, Vita, maybe the reason why we are getting much higher VS removals from the T-pad, which starts with 70 degrees C, is because in this vessel, most of the proteins, humic acids, and sugars are already in the very small soluble phase at that temperature. So when they are fed to the second vessel, bacteria are able to chew them up, convert them to methane at a much faster rate and a much higher extent. That's why VS removals means all the organics, right? Volatile means organic, so that comprises of proteins, polysaccharides, and sugars, and humic acids. So that's the goal, but we are only looking at just first set of data. So if you were to, for example, plot this,
is this the unit for this axis?
Temperature. And this when you plot it both in milligram per liter, right? So this will be, you can either plot it in this percentage, milligram per liter divided by total proteins milligram per liter times 100. So then you maybe start with 50% and solubilization rate goes to something like that. So this may or may not be needed for your sizing, but it allows us to have a deeper understanding of why temperature is enhancing the VS removal rates. Anything else, Vita, from you?
That's it, yes.
So Vita hasn't measured some of the other parameters that we plan on measuring. So she's going to be measuring fecal coliforms coming out of the last stages for land application purposes. And then she will be measuring dewaterability of the final stages and to see if there is enhancement of the dewaterability through T-pad. If you can dewater faster, that means much lower volumes of biosolids that you transport to landfill or site, so that also translates to operational savings if you can enhance the dewaterability, and we know that normally thermal processes have that enhancement in the dewaterability rate of the final sludge. And yeah, so I think there is a class. Sure, we are done. Yeah, you can come in. Okay. So I don't think this file is ready to go to you guys yet,
mm-hmm.
but once Utah makes the changes and add more data at one point, we will email it to you.